Hi, now we're on to book two of the Nicomachean Ethics. We remember from book one that we've arrived at this definition of happiness as an activity of the soul in accord with virtue. Aristotle starts off book two of the Nicomachean Ethics by distinguishing between two kinds of virtue, virtue of thought and virtue of character. What I have is intellectual and moral virtue here. He transitions from term to term, or at least the translator does, fairly freely, but nonetheless, moral virtue is virtue of character, and intellectual virtue is virtue of thought. Makes a little bit of sense here. Now, what Aristotle is trying to argue, he begins by just stating in at the start of book two of the Nicomachean Ethics, is that this book, or any book, is not going to help you develop moral virtue or virtue of character. He defines moral virtue or virtue of character as a habitual disposition to our emotion resulting in states of character, right? Annoyingly far into book two, way over on page 23 in section 5, virtue of character, its genus, right? He points out that this distinction that brings about the term states of character, in terms of our emotions, moral virtue is habitual disposition to our emotions, that he says results in states of character. In order to understand what the term states means, he has to distinguish that between feelings, emotions largely, and he lists off appetite, anger, fear, confidence, envy, joy, love, hate, longing, jealousy, pity, and in general, whatever implies pleasure or pain, right? Those are our feelings, or emotions, you might say, capacities, right? Which he defines as, by capacities, I mean what we have when we are said to be capable of these feelings, capable of being angry, for instance, or of being afraid, or of feeling pity, right? States are distinct from that, and what he means by states is what we have when we are well or badly off in relation to our feelings. For instance, our feeling is too intense or slack, we are badly off in relation to anger, but if it's intermediate, we are well off, and the same is true of other cases, right? So states of character result from this habitual disposition, right? A state of character can be excessive, deficient, or intermediate, which is what Aristotle is going to be driving on for his evaluatory mechanism to provide the distinction between virtues and vices. Now, what he's getting at here, right, is that we are not praised or blamed for experiencing an emotion, right? Nor are we praised or blamed for our capacity to experience an emotion, right? We are blamed, however, for how we act on that emotion. And the example I've been using for years is, let's say I'm on I-75, cruising out to Oakland University, and somebody cuts me off so dangerously they nearly take the front end of my car over, or off, right? Now, nobody would blame me for feeling both fear and anger in that situation. Right? Somebody almost hits my car, I'm going to be angry. Somebody's about to hit my car, I'm going to experience fear. Does that make me a coward? No. Does that make me a hothead? No. Right? Because you're going to be angry. Right? We're not even praised or blamed for the capacity to experience fear or anger. Right? We're all capable of these emotions, and it's perfectly natural to experience both fear and anger in that situation. Now, what I would be blamed for is if I, upon nearly being cut off and hit by another vehicle, right, decided to gun it, force this car off the road, go into my trunk, grab my 9-iron, and smash this guy's windshield in. Right? It's how we act with regard to these emotions, which we're not praised or blamed for the emotions themselves, but how we act and react to those emotions. So, that's what moral virtue is. It's a habitual disposition to our emotions that results in a tendency to act in a particular way. All right? So, in very general terms, that's what virtue of character is. And this agrees with our intuitive sense of it, too. If somebody is habitually late, right, generally, that's what we mean, right? And that contributes to their character. Their character is how they tend to act on the basis of their emotions. If they have a fear of getting caught or being poorly thought of, they might become liars or misrepresent themselves. They might avoid conflict if they're fearful of that sort of conflict, right? So largely, right, these habits that we develop make us who we are, and these habits that we develop govern the kinds of actions that, for the most part, in the heat of the moment, we're going to engage in, right? Now, what Aristotle's move is in Book 2 of the Nicomachean Ethics, it's not just to define moral virtue or virtue of character, but to actually put the onus on us for being responsible for crafting this character, right? For sort of crafting who we are by turning happiness into an activity of the soul in accord with virtue, and by defining moral virtue this way, right, what Aristotle has turned happiness into is sort of an exercise of skill. And how do we develop any sort of skill? Right? If you're a musician, how do you become a good musician? By reading about it? By reading sheet music? Well, that's sort of part of it. By thinking about it? No. If you're going to learn how to play an instrument, you've got to practice. How do you become a good golfer? By watching the Golf Network? You might think about golf. You might pick up tips on your swing or what sort of club to use under what circumstance. But really, what you have to do is mobilize until the exercise of the particular skill becomes habitual and feels quite natural to you. Right? So, moral virtue or virtue of character is not going to be a theoretical exercise when it comes to developing it. It's going to be a practical exercise that involves practice, the same way we get to Carnegie Hall, right? Practice, practice, practice. And what Aristotle has pointed out to us by defining moral virtue this way is the extent to which we in life are just on zombie autopilot. Zombie autopilot. We don't think, because in the heat of the moment of a moral situation or a practical situation, for the most part, we don't have time to think. Somebody starts yelling at me, I have to determine in the heat of the moment, in that situation, exactly how I'm going to react. So if I react by punching that person in the face, I might be blamed for that. If I react if somebody's yelling at me, running away, or cowering in a corner or something like that, I might be blamed for that as well. So really, developing the right kind of habits for Aristotle is going to be the key to how we develop our character and thereby develop our virtues and thereby develop our ability to attain happiness. Right? So he's turned everything into a skill shot. Do we become good carpenters by reading about carpentry, by thinking about carpentry? No, we become good carpenters by building things out of wood. Right? That's what moral virtue is all about. We become good human beings by developing good habits. And how do we develop those good habits? Well, we have to practice. All right? So, virtue of character relies on habituation. All right? Now, skip over that. In section 4 of book 2 of the Nicomachean Ethics, this is your page 22. We've just said developing virtue of character, it's not going to be a theoretical exercise. It's going to be done by practice, right? What Aristotle wants to do is he wants to add some criteria to the kind of practice. I know from my own golf game, what I've done is I've habituated myself in the wrong way. In terms of golf, I've developed the wrong habits and therefore a poor skill level, right? So what Aristotle wants to do is sort of hem in what he means by how we develop a virtuous character versus a vicious character. So we become good by performing virtuous actions. But he claims on page 22 here, paragraph 2, section 4, but surely actions are not enough. Even in the case of crafts, for it's possible to produce a grammatical result by chance or by following someone else's instructions. To be grammarians, then, we must both produce a grammatical result and produce it grammatically. That is to say, produce it in accord with the grammatical knowledge in us. So, I've always hated that example. Like, every now and again, the kind of examples Aristotle uses, they're not clear, right? So this one, I translate using golf. I don't know if you're golfers. I golf a little bit, insert sport here, largely, right? So I'm going to use golf, and I'll just translate. But surely actions are not enough, even in the case of golf, for it's possible to produce a good golf shot by chance or by following someone else's instructions. To be good golfers, then, we must produce a decent shot and produce it in accord with the golf knowledge in us. Right? So we've got this distinction between lucky shot, right, and someone who is able to mobilize their understanding of the golf swing in order to produce a decent shot. Right? There's, I think, a valid distinction. If you've seen my game, it's I occasionally have a lucky shot. I get congratulated for it. But as Aristotle would say, I don't deserve praise for it. Why? He adds these four criteria. Rather, the agent must also be in the right state when he does them. First, he must know that he's doing virtuous actions. You can't do it accidentally. When I was first in the UK, I was passing a panhandler. Right, and this panhandler was just looking for money and that sort of thing, and I didn't really understand the pound sterling that were in my pocket, that sort of thing, and I threw something like the equivalent of 20 Canadian dollars into his case, kind of thing, before I realized what the currency really translated to. Do I get credit for that? No, of course not. I did it accidentally. Another example, I was first taking driver's instruction. I was driving down the street on sort of a side road. It was a one-way street, and my driving instructor turned to me and said, Grant, you're doing something very good here. Well, that's nice to hear. What am I doing? Well, what you're doing is you're safely driving very close to the lane of parked cars over there. Oh, am I? I look over my shoulder. Whoa! Right? I had no idea that I was doing it, right? Another example, I-75. I'm occasionally listening to NPR and it gets boring. And so I'm on I-75, usually in the fast lane, and I start futzing with my CDs. I'm putting in a CD, my speed goes down, I look up, somebody has merged in front of me and given me a thank you wave. In none of those cases do I deserve credit. Why? Because I don't even know I'm performing the action. Right? So in a sense, you have to do a virtuous action on purpose for it to contribute to the development of a virtuous character. If you're just doing it by accident, you don't know that you're doing it. So in other situations, like the one that you're in, the kind of action won't be produced again, right? The idea is to produce a character that habitually does these kinds of virtuous actions. Right? So that's the first criteria. First, he must know that he's doing virtuous actions. Second, and this is very clever, we don't see this until Immanuel Kant again in moral theory. Second, he must decide on them and decide on them for themselves. I usually explain this using an Immanuel Kant example out of, believe it or not, The Idiot's Guide to Understanding Ethics. This is the case of kindly old Mrs. Smith and, let's just for now, call him Pete. All right. Kindly old Mrs. Smith has just left the grocery store very, very overladen with too many grocery bags. She's really struggling to carry these grocery bags home from the grocery store. She's on foot. Pete sees her and decides to go up to Mrs. Smith and say, "Hey, I used to help my grandma with her groceries. Could I give you a hand?" Mrs. Smith agrees, and they both head off towards her home, Pete carrying half of her burden. Well, as they're walking, Pete formulates his plan. As soon as they get to the old lady's house, what he's going to do is drop the grocery bags, grab her purse, and run. But just as they round the corner to Mrs. Smith's house, there's a police officer standing on the corner. So instead, he helps her to the door. She thanks him and thinks to herself, "What a kind young man." Did Pete do a good thing? Interestingly, the intention behind the action seems to color the action. Immanuel Kant would say no, because for Kant, the moral nature of the action depends on the intention behind the action. Aristotle's got a more an interesting way to handle this particular situation. If the goal is to, and the case is actually called the case of kindly old Mrs. Smith and sneaky Pete, right? If the goal is to develop a virtuous character, to develop moral virtue through this process of habituation, right? And in fact, it is Pete's intention to rob this lady. What did Pete learn from that experience? Perhaps he shouldn't wait until the old lady gets home to grab her purse. Maybe he just gets straight down to business. So he's habituating the wrong thing, right? So we're trying to produce a habitual disposition to our emotions resulting in a state of character. First off, we gotta know what the hell we're doing. Secondly, we've gotta do the virtuous act for the sake of its virtue. We've gotta do the right thing for the right reason. Otherwise, if we're doing it for the wrong reason, we're developing the wrong kinds of habits. We're developing vicious habits rather than virtuous habits, right? And then finally, third, he must also do them from a firm and unchanging state, which is a fancy way of saying that in order for these virtuous actions to translate into a virtuous character, you've got to make a habit out of it. One swallow, as they say, does not make the spring, right? One virtuous action does not produce a virtuous character, right? So, in order to develop moral virtue or virtue of character, right, what we have to do is repeat the same sorts of actions over and over again. We've got to know what the heck we're doing in order to, in a sense, habituate ourselves to those particular kinds of actions. We've got to do it for the sake of virtue, otherwise it's not genuine virtue that we're habituating, but rather something other than that, perhaps vice. Right? And then finally, we've got to successfully translate this series of actions into a habitual disposition for it to actually become our character and for those actions to be automatically produced in the spur of the moment when we're making decisions. Now, Aristotle had, well, how do we know a virtue from a vice? That's the question. Well, Aristotle's got this chart for explaining the distinction between virtues and vices, right? And we call it the golden mean of moderation because Aristotle notices that the mean or moderate state is generally the state that we aim at as a virtue, and that virtue tends to be ruined by extreme states of excess and deficiency. The classic example is that of a foot soldier. The idea is courage, right? If you're a foot soldier in the Athenian military, right, what you have to do is stay very, very close to your company and march in step with them. Let's say it's you and your nine friends trying to take a hill from 10 other guys. If you're marching towards that hill, it's best to keep step with your company. Advantage of numbers, right? And the emotion that you'd be experiencing, as anybody who might be in a conflictive situation would know, certainly any soldier would know, has to be fear, right? Because you're putting your life on the line here, right? Now, what would happen if instead of marching steadily along with your company, controlling your fear, and doing what needs to be done, somebody were to, say, wet themselves, drop their sword, run home, and hide under their bed instead? We might call that cowardice. We might call that cowardice. And that's what Aristotle defines as deficient vice, right? You're trying to produce the appropriate response with regard to the perfectly natural emotion that's going on in the situation that you're in, right? And if you react deficiently with regard to that emotion, say by wetting yourself and hiding under your bed, then you're called coward, right? Courage is something other than that. Now, likewise, let's say, same situation, you and your nine buddies trying to take this hill from those 10 guys, you're marching in step and that sort of thing. You experience fear and you decide, to heck with it, I just got to do it, I'm going to lose it, and you cry out, ah! And you run way ahead of your nine buddies at these 10 guys with your sword. How's that going to work out? Likely, you know, 10 against 1, and then your nine buddies are a man short. Not well. Not well. We might call that person a hothead. So, that's an excessive vice. What Aristotle wants to argue is that in most situations, in most moral situations, in most practical situations as well, you're just trying not to overreact, you're trying not to underreact. What you're trying to do is react with the appropriate response, which is somewhere in the middle of the excessive vices of deficiency and, well, of the vices of deficiency and excess. So the mean state, the moderate state, is generally considered to be the virtuous state. Now, let's go back to my driving example. Somebody cuts me off, I force them off the road, I start smashing in their window. Well, that might be considered excessive vice. And it's going to, one, land me in jail, or two, land me severely injured or dead in a hospital, right? In any case, three, it's not going to get me what I want, which is to work safely, securely, and in a timely manner, right? So, ideally, right, what I would do is drive defensively, right? Now, a deficient vice might be something along these lines. Okay, to hell with it, I'm not doing it, I'm quitting my job, and I'm never driving on the interstate again. That's not going to get me what I want either, right? So it's, again, an example of a situation where you don't want to overreact, you don't want to underreact, you just want to really watch yourself on the road and understand that people are likely to try and cut you off. It's I-75. Right? So, again, the golden mean is the target at which we aim. And the goal is to develop a habitual tendency to do the virtuous or moderate thing, not overreacting, not underreacting, but somewhere in the middle. Now, let's say you're in a relationship and your partner is doing something that you really don't like, right? You could yell and scream at them or even hit them. That's not going to be good for your relationship. You could suffer it in silence. That's also not going to be good for your relationship. Or you could just calmly and rationally, controlling your emotion of anger, have a discussion about how you would like that situation to go down, thereby managing the situation and getting you what you want, so you're not suffering it in silence, without overreacting and having you become a jerk, right? So what Aristotle is arguing here is it's the golden mean of moderation that produces a habitual disposition to act that is going to be practically beneficial to you and intrinsically valuable, because if you're able to control yourself, it also feels really good, right? There's an immediate reward to performing virtuously, right? One more example, let's take public speaking. I've got to say, right, that in order to achieve my goals, in order to live a decent and happy life, I studied philosophy. It's going to involve me speaking to groups of people about these ideas. Now, I used to be a really bad public speaker. So, it was horrible. It was just awful, right? Now, I was reacting very fearfully to the act of public speaking. I didn't want to do it, avoided it like the plague, and when I did have to do it, it went really, really poorly because I was unpracticed at it. Well, here's an interesting thing about Aristotle's theoretical approach to this. When you've got a habit, think about it. Do you chew your nails? Do you tap your foot? Do you hum to yourself? That sort of thing. Most of the time you're exercising a habit, you don't even notice you're exercising a habit. These are habits for a reason, because you're on autopilot. So it's not in terms of your habitual disposition that you're going to be able to correct a habit. That's where practical wisdom or prudence comes in. All of a sudden you realize, well, I've got this habit, I'm going to have to work to change this habit, because you do it so automatically you don't even think about it. Right? So prudence or practical wisdom is that faculty, that intellectual virtue that allows you to, in a sense, train yourself habitually. It first identifies that you've got a habit in the first place, being a bad public speaker in my case. It also points out that that habit, in my case a deficient vice, is going to prevent you from getting what you want, because for Christ's sakes, you studied philosophy. What was your career plan? Right? You're going to have to speak about ideas in public. That's just the way it goes, right? And you cannot achieve your ends without developing this particular ability, right? So, I had this deficient vice. Prudence also steps in and suggests a course of action. If you want to get over that deficient vice, if you want to become a good public speaker, what you have to do is speak publicly. So it suggests that I force myself to public speak, and what's more, take a number of opportunities to speak publicly until it feels comfortable and natural. The way when you get a decent golf swing, it feels comfortable and natural to do it. If it doesn't feel right, you haven't habituated yet. Right? Feels weird initially. And you've got to, in a sense, retrain yourself to virtue. Right? And ultimately, right, it's prudence or practical wisdom that allows us to step in and train ourselves better than that dog that I was speaking of in the last video. That dog that has a contradiction between what it wants and what it wants, the intellectual virtue of prudence or practical wisdom, which is that virtue, that sort of virtue that allows you to choose the best means to achieve your given ends, steps in and allows you to train your character. Right? and through the development of moral virtue. It's sometimes hard to be honest, but for Aristotle, there's such a thing as excessive honesty. On the golf course, I bump into this, where people volunteer advice I didn't ask for. Huh? Who asked you? Random people coming up to me. No, no, you gotta watch your backswing there. Who asked you? Go play your game. Right? That's excessive honesty. There's such a thing as deficient honesty, too. Somebody's a liar, they're deficiently honest. Sometimes it's scary to say the right thing. It's going to be a matter of training yourself to achieve the mean, and it's going to be prudence that allows you to train yourself how to breach the mean. On top of that, what does prudence have to do with this? Well, think about it. Particular situations are different. You ever find yourself in that situation? It's like, well, what do I do in this situation? Would this be an overreaction? Am I underreacting? And what's the appropriate thing? How angry should I be with this person for how long? What do I say to this person? Is that too much? Do I just let it drop and not tell this person that so-and-so is cheating on them or something along those lines? What's the right thing to do in this situation? Particular situations, it's prudence or practical wisdom that allows you to handle a particular kind of situation. It involves and relies upon the fact that you've already got the habit. You've already got this disposition that wants to react moderately. Right? But a particular situation is also handled by prudence or practical wisdom as well. Right? So, that's where there's the dotty line between practical wisdom and moral virtue, because the one cannot achieve its aim with the other, or vice versa. If you're just on habitual disposition mode, you can't handle a particular situation. And what's more, you can't train yourself to virtue without practical wisdom. Practical wisdom alone makes you calculative. It makes you calculative. Right? So, you're always stuck in this means ends kinds of consideration, where the ends themselves are never really evaluated in terms of their virtue. Right? So, right, this is somebody who's tactically intelligent, yet not, you know, morally intelligent. Right? So, all right. What else do we have here? Boo, 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 boo. Yeah, we're already out of it. I've already gone a little too far here. Where is it? Where did it go? All right. So, let's take one more example. Now, what? What shall we use? Now, I don't want to do it too often. I don't want to do it not at all. I want to do it sometimes and not excessively, not deficiently, but somewhere in the middle. So, let's say on the second Tuesday of every fifth month, I kill someone. It's not all the time. Right? But it's not at all either, right? Aristotle bars the door to that, right? He says on your page 25, not every action or feeling admits of the mean. For the names of some automatically include baseness. For instance, spite, shamelessness, envy among feelings, adultery, theft, murder among actions. For all of these and similar things are called these names because they themselves, not their excesses or deficiencies, are base. Hence, in doing these things, we can never be correct, but must invariably be in error. We cannot do them well or not well by committing adultery, for instance, with the right woman at the right time in the right way. On the contrary, it is true without qualification that to do any of them is to be in error. Now, this leads to a bit of a puzzle in Aristotle. This is one of the areas in which Aristotle isn't too terribly clear, but nonetheless, he does give us some hints in order to help us figure out what the heck he's talking about. Because in a sense, who says what gets tossed on that list? Right? He's given us a list here, right? Spite, shamelessness, envy among feelings, adultery, theft, murder among actions. These are just examples. Who gets to say what's on that list, right? That list of actions that do not admit of a mean, right? Well, he's given us a hint here. And we can build arguments in terms of the structure of this argument to handle each particular case. But nonetheless, I think the best example he's given us is among feelings, shamelessness. Think about the word, shamelessness. It's already a deficient vice. Right? It's a deficiency of shame. Right? You would be shameless if you are... Well, deficient with regard to shame. I just said that. Right. There would also be an excess shamefulness, right? Somebody who is too, let's say, bashful or shy, that sort of thing. And it prevents them from getting the big H, right? Getting what they want, right? And somewhere in there, with regard to shame, there is a mean, which we call the virtue. Right, approach appropriately sensitive to how we're being perceived by others. Right, so already with that one example, he's already shown us that really those actions that do not admit of a mean are just names that we have for deficiencies or excesses. So already vices. Right, so. He continues here. To think these admit of a mean, therefore, is like thinking that unjust or cowardly or intemperate action also admits of a mean, an excess, and a deficiency. If it did, there would be a mean of excess, a mean of deficiency, an excess of excess, a deficiency of deficiency. On the contrary, there is no excess or deficiency of temperance or bravery, since the intermediate is a sort of extreme. So also, there is no mean of these vicious actions either. But whatever way anyone does them, he is in error. For in general, there is no mean of excess or deficiency, and no excess or deficiency of the mean. Right? So he's just kind of, not sufficiently clearly for my tastes, but this is an old text. It survived thousands of years. Right? But nonetheless, he's given us a roadmap. So the mean is already the mean. Now, unfortunately, we already have names for some of these habitual dispositions, which are already vices, right? You can't be moderately cowardly because cowardly is already the deficient vice, right? You can't be moderately a hothead, right? Because the excess is already an excessive vice, right? So the golden mean of moderation seems to handle even these extremes. Now, Aristotle at the Lyceum, there are references in some of the footnotes. Now let's go to the list. Well, apparently in the classrooms at the Lyceum when Aristotle was teaching this stuff, he and his students made a list that would just cover all of the walls of various virtues and their requisite excessive and deficient vices. Right? Now, we don't have names for a lot of these, but nonetheless, that's what we are doing. This is the general structure, right? Now, let's conclude chapter 2. Boop, 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 boop. All right. Now, on the last couple of pages, page 29 over to 30, I like to call this sort of horseshoes, hand grenades, and Aristotelian ethics, right? Close enough is kind of good enough. Already way back in book one, he already said that, like, look, our goal is to grasp this in general outline, and we should only require a level of precision that's appropriate to the object of inquiry, right? In summary, paragraph 7, section 9 of book 2 on your page 29. Then, if we do these things, we shall be best able to reach the intermediate condition. Right? But presumably, this is difficult, especially in particular cases, since it's not easy to define the way we should be angry, with whom, about what, for how long. Sometimes, indeed, we praise deficient people and call them mild. And sometimes we praise quarrelsome people and call them manly. Still, we're not blamed if we deviate a little in excess or deficiency from doing well, but only if we deviate a long way, since we're easily noticed. But how great and how serious a deviation receives blame is not easy to define in an account, for nothing else perceptible is easily defined either. Such things are among particulars, and the judgment depends on perception. This is actually an aspect of Aristotelian ethics I like. It's decisively simple for modernist ethics, which likes to, in very simple terms, delineate between permissible and impermissible. Is this permissible or not, right? And it focuses on an individual action. By focusing on character, what Aristotle has done is made this sort of a rough target that we aim at. Sometimes we are a little deficient, sometimes we're a little excessive, but nonetheless, if we're aiming at this target, we are likely to produce a virtuous character, and therefore that virtue is likely to help us produce happiness. Now, the modernist approach to ethics, and I think this is a misunderstanding of people who appropriate the modernist approach to ethics, but nonetheless, it tends towards, by focusing on the action rather than on the character of the actor, it tends to show us that if we lie, we're wrong, and if we're wrong, we're bad, so you're bad because you lied. Just bad. You know, you lied that one time, so you're not a good person. That one time you stole bread to feed your family. Is it permissible to steal? No, in principle, it's not permissible to steal. Therefore, you're a thief. Your character is branded as a thief, and for the rest of your life, you're never going to be anything. It's completely absolutist and unforgiving, which is not how we operate. We tend to forgive people, and we tend to look at it generally how they tend to act throughout their lives. There are some actions that are so excessive or so deficient that we have traces of these actions left for their entire lives, and we determine whether or not we can forgive these people. As Aristotle points out, on 29 again, how angry we should be with whom, about what, and for how long, right? These things are, if the violation of virtue, if the vice is so excessive and so extreme, it might actually be harder to forgive. But nonetheless, right, it has to do with the character of the person and not with the action itself, right? Producing in people a tendency to act in a particular way. I like this. I like this aspect of the ancients' virtue ethics. Right? So, that's virtue of character. Now, we only have one sort of section of Book 3 of the Nicomachean Ethics to go through. And largely, it points out to us the nature of moral responsibility, right? To what extent we can be held responsible. We'll just get some board space here, and we'll quickly go through this argument. Again, I like this argument. Maybe the fact that I like about Aristotle is a little too persuasive, but nonetheless, right? We know virtue we praise, and vice we blame. Praise and blame are only for the voluntary. Right? So, in terms of moral responsibility, in order to hold us responsible for our virtues and our vices, in order to praise virtue and blame vice, these things have to be voluntary. Now, what he wants to do is define voluntary annoyingly by what it's not. involuntary. That which is involuntary falls into two very narrow categories. One, force, and ignorance. One, two. In which case, if the action is occasioned by either force or ignorance, you see I've got an asterisk there, you're straight off the hook for the action. Now, we might understand force. He means it pretty literally. You know that game that older brothers play with younger brothers where they hold them down, make them hit their own face with their own hand kind of thing, and say, why are you hitting yourself? Why are you hitting yourself? That might be what Aristotle means by force. It's that kind of action, right? That is occasioned by force. The agency does not, originate from the actor, right? Or, for example, if somebody pushes me, I bump into you, you drop your books. I'm straight off the hook for that because whoever pushed me is responsible for that action. The force, the agency, didn't originate from me. I'm just sort of a billiard ball hitting another billiard ball in that particular situation. So you can see how little of our volitional activity is actually off the hook here, right? This isn't, in fact, volitional activity. It's not voluntary activity. How few things actually are occasioned by force? It's quite a narrow, narrow, narrow field. Whatever isn't involuntary is voluntary. Secondly, ignorance. And we've got an asterisk here. A couple of caveats here. Ignorance. Ignorance has to be relevant to the situation. Right? Let's say I open a door, that door smacks you in the face, and I say, oh, geez, I'm sorry, I didn't see you there. Right? That's relevant. Right? Let's say I open a door, that door smacks you in the face, and I say, sorry, I didn't know your name was Bob. So what? You just hit me in the face with a door. I don't care if you know what my name is. So it's got to be relevant, pertinent to the situation, in a way that would actually help and craft and affect your particular action. Right? You've got to be sort of ignorant of something that's relevant to the situation. Secondly, what about, I did see you behind the, I was given every opportunity to see you on the other side of that door. I open the door, it hits you in the face, because I just bloody well wasn't paying attention. I say, whoops, I didn't see you there. Am I off the hook? No, of course not, because I should have bloody well seen you there. Just like, let's say, I hit you with my car and say, sorry, I wasn't paying attention. I'm responsible for paying attention. The ignorance also has to be unavoidable kind of ignorance. Right? So, force and ignorance are those two kinds of occasion under which you're straight off the hook for your actions. Right? Everything else is voluntary. One more example. Let's say I go out drinking with my colleagues. I get so bloody plastered that I start bad-mouthing them all to their faces. Hank of you. Am I off the hook because I'm so plastered I don't know up from down or what I'm saying? Well, it seems relevant to the situation. Right? If I weren't that drunk, I'd never say these sorts of things. But the conditions of my ignorance are up to me under my control, so I'm responsible for producing the conditions of my ignorance that, oh, it looks like a D, sorry about that. You get the idea, it's ignorance. So, it's a pretty narrow sphere of the involuntary. Well, one more caveat, that Aristotle wants to add here, and it's a pretty important one, I tend to think, and political theorists dispute this. Is that really important? I'm a philosopher, and I think in terms of ethicists, it is really important, right? Paragraph 13, section 1, book 3, or page 31. Everything caused by ignorance is non-voluntary. Darn, new term, right? You've got involuntary, voluntary, and then we have this new category here of the non-voluntary. But what is involuntary also involves pain and regret. For someone's action was caused by ignorance, but he now has no objection to the action. He has neither done it willingly, since he did not know what it was, nor unwillingly, since he now feels no pain. Hence, among those who act because of ignorance, the agent who now regrets his action seems to be unwilling, but the agent with no regrets may be called non-willing, since he's another case, and it's nice for them to have their own names. So, what's Aristotle getting at here? We're on the hook for our voluntary actions, right? But what about these actions that are occasioned by ignorance? Let's even say it's the right kind of ignorance. I didn't see you on the other side of that door. I couldn't possibly have known that you're on the other side of the door. I open the door, I hit you in the face with the door, and I crack up laughing at the fact that I just broke your nose. I think it's funny. Right. Well, this is the kind of case that Aristotle is very worried about. It's an involuntary action occasioned by the proper, relevant, and unavoidable kind of ignorance that I'm cracking up at. Right? I might be off the hook for the action because anybody could have opened the door in that particular situation. Anybody could have broken your nose in that particular situation. It sucks. But nonetheless, it was relevant and unavoidable ignorance that occasioned that. It was just dumb luck, right? There's no way anybody could have avoided that situation. But if I'm laughing because of having just broken your nose, what does that say about me? Well, you would be perfectly in your rights to actually say, okay, it was an involuntary action insofar as it was ignorance of the relevant and unavoidable kind, but still, what a jerk. What a jerk. He's pleased that he broke my nose. This shows that Aristotle is up to something a little bit deeper than just holding us responsible for actions. Remember, this is what I liked about book 2 of the Nicomachean Ethics, Horseshoes, Hand Grenades, and Ethics. Close enough is good enough. We're concerned about developing a virtuous character rather than simply producing this action, that action, the other action, which are narrowly construed as permissible, right? This non-voluntary distinction actually shows that we're responsible for more than just sort of our legalistic interpretation of how we produce a particular action, but we're also responsible for what sorts of people we are. Now, there is, you see this asterisk, you know, the sentence that starts with everything caused by ignorance on page 31 over to 32, since he now feels no pain, you see that asterisk there? Well, way at the back of the book, and you may find this handy for all sorts of things, on your page 203, you will see this keys to book 3, section 1, paragraph 13. You'll see at the bottom of 203, four of someone's ... no pain. Well, we know that's the sentence that we're referring to in the paragraph in the section in the book that we're referring to. And then there's a little explanation. All throughout this book, there have been good explanations, and that's one of the reasons I use this particular rendition of Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics. This reads, the distinction between non-voluntary and involuntary is irrelevant to the agent's relation to his action, for in either case, he's not responsible for it. You see, right off the hook. But it is relevant to his character. If he's pleased at something he has done because of ignorance, he shows what sorts of actions he's willing and prepared to do, and is rightly blamed or praised for his attitude to these actions. The passage is one that shows Aristotle is concerned with more than responsibility for actions. See note to paragraph 3 above. So, that footnote is very handy, because I'm going to ask you a question about the non-voluntary and voluntary distinction at some point, right? So that's books 2 and the smattering of book 3 of the Nicomachean Ethics that I'm concerned about. I could have said more about the development of virtue of character with regard to it being rather difficult, because sometimes, if you have a deficient vice, the virtue seems almost excessive to you. So the object is sort of deceptive, right? Sometimes the extremes seem more similar to the mean. For example, rashness to courage versus cowardice to courage, right? So if somebody's overreacting to the emotion of fear, rashness seems more like courage, the steady sort of handle your fear and do what needs to get done, than wetting yourself and hiding under your bed, right? Sometimes these things are deceptive. What's more, we're already biased towards pleasure and away from pain. So with regard to eating sweets or drinking alcohol or that sort of thing, what Aristotle points out is that we already tend towards pleasure and away from pain, whereas that's not always a good thing. So we have to become aware of our own misleading proclivities, as he puts it. Right. But nonetheless, that's, I think, a pretty decent overview of this section of the Nicomachean Ethics. And I look forward to hearing what you have to say about them. Thank you.